Welcome back, Troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. Fender's launching day. We have a brand new Acoustasonic product that's less expensive than the other ones that we've seen on the show or on various other channels. So the biggest critique most people had with the original Acoustasonic series, which if you're not familiar, it's Fender's take on an acoustic guitar, but more so an electric guitar proportions. Like, it's a guitar that's produced for electric guitar players that sounds like acoustics. And you can check out my other review and demo of the Stratocaster version. To quickly summarize what I felt about the other one, these are great for somebody who does like coffee house type gigs. You can get some very realistic acoustic sounds within this, you know, for an electric guitar with a piezo system. And it's all in one compact package. And I was pretty happy with it overall. I did tend to agree with most people that $2,000 was a bit expensive for what it was, because a lot of people would say, well, why don't you just buy a really nice electric for $1,000 and a really nice acoustic for $1,000, and you kind of got the same thing, because those were $2,000. So Fender listened to you guys. They developed a brand new facility down in Mexico for the Acoustasonic Player series. And this is one of the first ones off the line that we're gonna check out today. So keep in mind, this is a sponsored review and demo. I don't get to keep the guitar, but I am being compensated for creating this video. I'm still gonna tell you the truth. But let's go ahead and crack this open. So far, it seems like the gig bag is about the same as the US one. You've got a nice back padding right here, and I would assume we have some sort of a strap system back here. Yep, you've got two straps, so you can wear it like a traditional backpack. Or if you don't need those at all, they just zip up back here. Got those tire bumpers on the bottom, so you know you don't have to worry about cracking your instrument. For a gig bag, this is actually pretty nice. But let's go ahead and see the new player series. All right, so they sent me kind of the more tobacco-y sunburst one, but these are being offered in four different finishes this time. So we've got the one we're talking about today. It is called Shadow Burst. It's basically tobacco sunburst with just a fancy name. It's kind of like an orangish brown into a straight up brown. But then they've got butterscotch blonde, brushed black, and Arctic White. I thought Arctic White looked pretty cool, so I told Fender, generally they send these out to quite a few channels. They said they were going to dial that down a little bit so you guys don't get influxed with like 60 videos of these things within the same day. And I told them to send the one that everybody's not picking. That way we get different colors. So I'm happy with this one. All right, so first feel here. I know I'm not talking too much. It doesn't feel all that different from the US one. Now, granted, I only had the Stratocaster. I never had the Telecaster, so this is kind of a first for me in a roundabout way. But it feels very good. It even looks very similar to the US one because they have the walnut cap on the top. Normally, the Made in Mexico ones, they don't do that. They do the black plastic. I mean, sure, it says Mexico on the back and has the Mexican style serial number, but they still gave you that carve. Now, I'm noticing there's a lot of different stuff right here that's a little bit different from the US version. Like, our output jack is now just a regular output jack. It doesn't have a charging port right there. It appears, okay, we're doing actual batteries this time. And now we've got the plastic back plates instead of the metal ones. They have this Bovita thing in here. I think that's to absorb moisture or something like that. Okay, yeah. If you've wanted one of these, but you're kind of waiting for a cheaper version, so far, this feels really good to me. I mean, the high-end ones are also the satin finish. This is the same thing. It's satin. I'd almost say I like the knobs on this one even more. They still did the wooden treatment to it. It's kind of almost like a rosewood this time. But what have they changed on these to make them cheaper? Obviously, they've got their brand new plant down in Mexico, so that makes the labor a bit cheaper. But they also kind of did their best hits. So you no longer have 10 different tonal opportunities. So last time you had a 5 position switch on these with a mod knob that let you choose between sound A and sound B. You could actually blend in between those two. This one, they chopped that down to 3 different sounds with 2 options between them that you can blend. So that's 6 different opportunities on this one. So you lost 4, but I mean, that's still pretty darn good, I would say. And instead of the ebony fretboard, we're now rocking a rosewood, but to be honest, most of those ebonies were really streaky. It doesn't look that different from rosewood on these guys, so that's actually pretty darn cool here. Oh, and the other thing that I think you've lost here is the body sensor pickup. So the one that you go to make it sound through the guitar, tapping on it. I don't believe we have that on the Mexican variation. So these things were specifically developed for those people who just thought, oh, just buy two guitars. Because now that this one, the price point is $1,200. So it's about $800 cheaper. So far, it feels very similar. Sure, you're losing some of the different sounds, but I think six is pretty darn good. And not everybody taps on their instruments, so you don't necessarily need the body sensor pickup. So now that we know a little bit about the new Acoustasonic Player Series Made in Mexico Acoustasonic Telecaster, man, that takes forever to say, let's go ahead and throw it on the workbench, take an individual look at its parts and specs before we get to that playing demo. Inside the new Player Series Acoustasonic Telecaster. So as I was telling you earlier, it's a satin finish. Now, as you play this over time, you might get some buffed up areas, but I think that's why these things feel so similar to the USA counterparts, is because those are also satin. Now, if those things would have been gloss, like they do have exotic wood versions that are more expensive that I think they're gloss. I'm not sure. I actually haven't had one of those things in person yet. Those would feel significantly different, but since, you know, they're going for that player satin everywhere on this thing, you know, it really does feel surprisingly good. If nothing else, you know, maybe check one out at a store if you liked the original ones and you just couldn't afford it. But just like last time, you have an inlaid spruce top with a mahogany back. So you can see the start of the spruce right there, and then they have like a black bound layer around there before you meet into the finish right here. And then you can also see the spruce top right here within the rosette around here, which has a couple of other rings going around before they get to the mahogany circle right here. So what you've got going on here is this is just exposing the backside of the instrument. And they make this ring really thick, that way you can't see any of the electronics within it. So it just gives the illusion of, you know, it's just a regular acoustic guitar, right? But, you know, the thickness of an electric guitar. It's got a little bit of an arm contour right here, which isn't something you get on most Telecasters. And if this is anything like the Stratocaster, it's going to be a little bit bigger than a regular Telecaster, but not by a whole lot. Unfortunately, I don't have a Telecaster to AB compare it to. But you have a magnetic pickup right here, and then you have your undersaddle piezo pickup right here. You can see the wires going through there, and then the bridge saddle just sits on top of that. The saddle itself is branded Graftech, probably their tusk material. It's the same thing they make the nut out of on these models. But they call this the N4 pickup. We'll take a look at it on the backside. And instead of ebony, this time we get rosewood parts. So rosewood bridge, rosewood knobs, which is a master volume, and then you're blending between the different sounds on this one. Which there's not any individual click or even an indentation on any of these, so you just kind of gotta know which sound you're on and just tune it in by ear. Then obviously you have your three-way selector switch right here to select your different tone banks. So we'll go a little bit more in depth on those when we get to the back, because we can't see anything from here, and my endoscope is too big to really fit through there, but we'll see all that on the back. So here, I think, is where Fender saved their butts. If they would have put Pau Ferro on these things, I would have been kind of upset, because rosewood looks and feels so much better. Now, I did condition this board, so if it looks a little bit darker than it did before, that's why. But the fact that we have real rosewood on a Mexican Fender makes me very happy. Now, unfortunately, there is a little bit of fret sprout on this one. It's not bad, but you can just barely feel it. Like, if you run your nail along it, you can kind of feel that. And I'm guessing that's because, you know, this thing was in Mexico, then it went to California, and then it came to me here in Ohio, and those are very different temperatures. So the neck is going to shrink a little bit, but the frets don't. But I would say this is like the worst area of that. You can kind of see how it's definitely protruding out right here. So that might be something you have to get filed down on yours if you want to purchase one. Or maybe just try one out at a store and maybe you can haggle in a fret desprout job. It's not that hard to do. You can just tape off your guitar and flatten them out if that happens to even be a problem on yours. This is livable. It's by no means, ah, oh, my fingers. It's just, hey, I noticed this and I'm doing a review, so I'll let you know. They've outfitted this with 22 narrow tall frets, and we've got a 25.5-inch scale length. Our nut is 1.64 inches, and that increases to 2.03 by the 12th, so kind of a skinnier neck. That's kind of nice. And then first fret neck depth, 0.82, and increases to 0.93 by the 12th. Fender calls this the modern deep sea neck profile shape. And I would say I agree with that. It's got a little bit of a hump on the back. It's not an overly thick neck, more so towards like 60s territory. And you really don't even feel that it chunks up that much. Here's what that profile looks like at the 1st fret and the 12th fret. Definitely widens up, but it's not a huge neck by any means. Moving on to the face of the headstock here, it's just that bare mahogany because it's a mahogany neck. Now, if you wonder why it's a little bit shinier here, it's because when I was conditioning the fretboard, I was like, I'm curious, would that shine that up? And yeah, you could put a little oil over top of that if you wanted it to look a little bit more gloss-like, but they still did the Fender etched in logo, the laser engraved. And that looks pretty good on this model. And you've got 6 modern style tuners on here with a single string tree. And once again, I really love their choice of a wooden cap, just like the USA variant right there. But now we move into the back and how my review will differ from everyone else's. Let's take a look at the guts. So here we can see the undersaddle piezo is right here. And last time when I tore apart that Stratocaster, I was confused where the body sensor pickup was, but it was that big black box right here. And you're gonna notice that, you know, that's clearly missing in this one. I could see that being a deal breaker for some people as to why they still buy the USA version. Like, there are some really acoustic tappity tappy type guys. For me, I don't really do that. So if they can cut that out to save some money, but maybe they could offer a version in the future that costs like, what, $100 more in order to put that in. But you have the Fender N4 pickup in the regular location right here. Just like on the other ones, they have to route a little bit out right there to fit the pickup within there. I always find that funny. But instead of a rechargeable battery on these guys, again, it's a 9-volt. I could see that being both a pro and a con. It's a negative because now you have a battery pack that you have to worry about this leaking. But at the same time, if you're at a gig and it's time to go, you don't have time to charge your thing. So there's pros and cons. Maybe you need one of these as like the backup for your stuff. But yeah, that has a 9-volt battery this time and it's built into the cover. I like that. I would assume when you plug it in, if this is a low battery, it's going to say, hey, you've got a low battery, because I think a lot of people were kind of scared about that last time. They didn't know how long the battery had left. So that's a nice little improvement. But then as far as the guts of the operation, now this looks a bit different to me, but that would make sense because this time it's branded Mexico Acoustasonic Telecaster REV5 by Fishman. So they changed up the sounds that are in this one, so the boards are going to be different than the USA counterparts. But interestingly enough, I wonder if they're the same size. I haven't actually torn them apart. Could you put a USA board in here? Like, if you just happen to find it, you know, say when this video is like 20 years old, when they're kind of cheaper on the used market or whatnot, could you upgrade a Mexican one to have all that other stuff? I guess you could also think of it like that as well. You could probably add your own body sensor pickup in here if it has the right connections. It might not. But it does still seem to be built on the Quick Connect system, but there's a little bit of hard wiring going on there. But nothing is plugged in right here. I'm wondering if that's where the body sensor pickup would go. I'm not sure. I'll just take a slow zoom over here. I mean, maybe these components make sense to somebody else that knows a little bit more about printed circuit boards or happens to find the spec sheets online. That looks like it's labeled P3, so maybe we'll figure out what that does in the future. There's your switch right there, and your output jack gets hardwired onto there. And again, that's just kind of like a regular styled output jack this time. But let's go ahead and break out the endoscope to actually see the inside of this guitar. Okay, let's start by diving into the back here. This is what's underneath the PCB system. Essentially, they just have like a shielding tape underneath there to ground all that stuff off. You can see a couple of capacitors on the back. Man, those will be a pain if you ever have to change those out. But those appear to be the knobs that are on the top. It controls the stuff that's on top of the PCB system. So pretty standard stuff, but have you ever seen it like this before? But as far as the inside of the instrument here, let's go diving. So you can see the glue line right here between the spruce top that meets onto the mahogany body. That's looking pretty good for the most part, nice and clean. I mean, you got a little bit of seeping out, but of course that's just what you're gonna have. But this is about the middle of the guitar. You can actually see some bracing along the edges where they put the undersaddle piezo on it. So you've got the bracing on both those sides right there. And in case you didn't notice, there's like an extra piece of wood where all that stuff is, just to help thicken that up. Because in the owner's manual of the USA ones, they tell you not to adjust the pickup height of these pickups in here because you could potentially crack the top.
But now continuing on past the electric pickup here, here's that sound hole rosette thing that you can see from the top, and there's just that very small gap on top that has the finish over top of it. That's kind of interesting to see. And that's all within that bracing, okay. But this is that top cutaway horn right there. And then this is the cutaway side. So far, it looks pretty clean and well-constructed. It's kind of hard to see the top, but you can see it right there, the spruce. I'm wondering, can we see where they actually inlay it in here? It's so far in the corner, but I think you can kind of see it right there. All right.
I think that's enough spelunking. So essentially, they've got that sound hole that pokes down here. They've got two bracing and another piece of wood right here. And then it's just typical glue seams around the rest of it. Now, you're probably curious, how many pieces is this body? I counted four. So looking at the end grain, you have a seam right here. There's one right there by the strap button, so that's two, three, and then one more around here for the fourth. I'll be honest, I don't know how many the American ones have, but you know, four piece, I'm sure that's a little bit more pieces than the USA version. But they still did this, which I'm kind of surprised, but very glad at the same time that they have that contoured heel right here. I mean, $1,200 is not cheap by any means, but there's been quite a few signature Fender guitars of artists that have been costing that much from the Mexican plant, sometimes even more. Look at the Tom Morello Stratocaster. But okay, I'm noticing something here. This is like a channel route, so that's not a 100% tight fit. You do have some like a additional space right here. Now, does that affect the guitar? I don't think so. But this is still a metal neck plate, whereas this has been changed to plastic. But in doing that, they have to put a shielding cover on the back of that. And I like the way that they ground off the output jack. There's just a metal wire that they string through a little hole right there so it comes in contact with that. But this one is MXA2101158, Ensenada, Mexico. It does appear to have the micro tilt adjustment in there as well. But back here, we've got that mahogany neck with that walnut skunk stripe in here. And no other serial number on this thing besides on the neck plate with our Fender tuners. All said and done, this weighs 5 pounds, about 2 ounces. Pretty much the only negative thing I can say about this as compared to the USA Stratocaster version is the action just is a tad higher than that other one. And unfortunately, when you have a saddle system like that, lowering the action isn't just as easy as just taking a screwdriver to lower it. You actually have to file down your saddle a little bit. So that's the only thing I really noticed that's different. And I'm not saying that the action's bad. I mean, especially for an acoustic guitar. Very comfortable in these registers. I think these are great for people who play electric guitar but want to sound like an acoustic. They're a little bit more convincing than other piezo systems, in my experience. I mean, we still have to see. Does this one sound any good? But that's where we're stopping next. Let's go ahead and plug it in. Keep in mind, I do not have a proper acoustic amp, so I'm running it through a regular electric guitar amp. So this will show you what that sounds like. These things can sound much better if you have the right style of amp. All right, let's go ahead and run through the tones of this thing. Remember, we only got 6 this time. And I'm just gonna kind of play with this for a little bit. I'm sure there's other reviews and demos on YouTube you can check out today as well. But I've got this tuned down to C sharp just because we've got acoustic strings on here and I can. But before we do the amplified segment, let's go ahead and see how this thing sounds just regularly. That's what I like about the acoustasonic range. I know there's some guys out there that don't like these things, but as a guitar that you can sit around like a campfire and just play, and it's loud enough without being like too loud, like you could also just be practicing in your room with this thing. My last video did a great comparison between a true acoustic guitar and like a semi-hollow in one of these. Let's go ahead and play that real quick again. Here's that compared to a semi-hollow guitar. Now for the comparison that you actually care about, a true acoustic guitar.
great for like coffee house serenading type stuff.
So this still has that exact same type of stuff. Now let's go ahead and see how the electronics sound. Starting with our blend knob all the way on 10 in our neck position. That's how the first selection sounds. So it's almost like you have, you know, some sort of an acoustic here. But as you roll your blend knob off, it kind of gets a little bit opener and more bassy. Also remember, wherever you pick on these things is very dependent on what types of tones you get. Now let's try our middle position, see how that sounds. Okay, that one's very different. It's almost like a blend between a dirty electric guitar and, you know, just a regular acoustic. That's kind of an interesting tone there. So that middle one's very versatile if you need to switch between acoustic and regular. Let's see what our bridge position has in store for us. Remember, at the time of recording, I don't know what any of these are called, so I'm just giving you general basics here. So I think this is meant to be like the dirty electric. It's got a vibe to it, but if that's really meant to be the dirty electric tone, I don't know if I like it that much. I think that's meant to be like the clean guitar tone here. Now let's try some distortion! I can't say using distortion on an acoustasonic would be something I would necessarily recommend in a live situation. It's not completely uncontrollable, but you know, if you get too crazy with it, you might deafen your audience. Really play with that volume knob, and yes, even though they don't necessarily say, hey, buy this to put a distortion pedal in front of it, it can be a lot of fun. So as far as the acoustic tones go on this thing, they're pretty nice. I like that one. So that is the blend knob turned off.
middle position. It's a little bit thinner. Definitely kind of like that blend of acoustic with the electric better on the two position. Then I can't say I'm convinced with the electric tones out of this. If you were literally straight up trying to replace your electric and acoustic guitars, I mean, it gets you close enough, don't get me wrong, but probably not cutting the cake. But these are a little bit less expensive, that, you know, you can have this if you just like acoustic guitars that are like this. I would still consider owning this thing. I like these things. Some guys don't, but I guess it really depends what you're kind of looking to do with this. If you just like kind of interesting guitars that can get you a whole bunch of different tones, yeah, it's great. I like it because every time I have one of these, it inspires me to play differently than I do on my other electrics. But it still feels like an electric, but yet you've got the acoustic style strings on here. So sometimes it's like good to practice riffs on one of these, then swap over to your 9-gauge strings on a real electric. And you know, it's just easier to play because these are such heavier gauge strings. Here's what it sounds like tuned up to pitch. I will tell you, having it detuned makes this play better, because you've got less string tension on here. Like, it feels kind of stiff right now. So if you ever tried one of these and thought it was stiff, try detuning it. Then you might actually end up enjoying it a bit better. So now that we know all about the new Player Series Acoustasonic Telecaster, what are my final thoughts on these things? If you wanted the original, you tried one at a store, you thought it was good, you just wished it wasn't as expensive, grab one of these. They're a lot of fun. I enjoy them anyways. Your results may vary. But this feels just like the USA version to me. They've really nailed down that feel. But again, it was pretty easy. They all came in satin finishes for the most part. From a demoing standpoint, it's a lot easier just to have the six tones. It's a little bit easier to make sense of. Now, granted, I do kind of miss some of the other tones that were in the other one, but for the trade-off of saving $800, I mean, you'll figure which ones you like out better. Now, I don't have any inside knowledge, but judging by the fact that they just created a whole Acoustasonic division factory in Mexico for these things, I'm betting next year we'll see the Stratocaster body style come out of that, and then we'll see the Jazzmaster, and then by then they should have the new USA version launched. I'm curious what they'll do next. Are we gonna go crazy with Duosonics? I mean, this seems to be a thing that is here to stay. So, Troglodytes, I hope you enjoyed checking out this new Mexican version of the Acoustasonic Telecaster and getting my first impressions on it. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Share this video with a friend who you think would enjoy it, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next episode. Take care.